Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, Sati does not mean mindfulness, since mind is not full. Yet rather, in this mental quality is stilled into a precise, unique, one-pointed focus. Sati is thus better translated as awareness or presence, which is one of the five spiritual abilities and powers, Indriya Bala, one of the seven factors of enlightenment, Bhuyanga, and the seventh method of the Eightfold Noble Way, Magga. And it is, in the widest sense, one of those mental factors inseparably associated with all mental, karmically advantageous, lofty and beautiful kinds of consciousness. It is continuously established by the four foundations of awareness, Satipatthana. One method to establish these four foundations of awareness is clear comprehension, Sampayana. And the explanation of acute awareness and clear comprehension goes like that. When inhaling and exhaling long, one notices and is fully aware of just that. When inhaling and exhaling short, one notices and is fully aware of just that. One trains, I will breathe in and out, clearly comprehending the entire body. One trains, I will breathe in and out, calming the breath and all bodily activity. When walking, one notices and clearly comprehends that one is walking. When standing, one notices and clearly comprehends that one is standing. When sitting, one notices and clearly comprehends that one is sitting down. When lying down, one notices and clearly comprehends that now one is lying down. When going forward, one clearly notices and comprehends that one is going forward. When returning, one notices and clearly comprehends this returning. When looking in front and back, one notices and clearly comprehends exactly that. When bending or stretching, when lifting or carrying, when eating or drinking, chewing or tasting, one is aware of and mentally labels just that. Chewing, chewing, tasting, tasting, swallowing, swallowing. When passing excrement or urine, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When falling asleep and when waking up, when speaking or keeping silence, one notices, knows, and understands exactly that. That this is what one is doing right here and exactly right now. Continuous awareness of purpose, suitability, domain, and nature of one's current behavior, whether mental, verbal, or bodily, is right awareness and clear comprehension. Thank you.
8 o'clock. Friday, 23 March 2018. Beautiful morning. Lovely morning. As I hope you can perceive in your end, the stress level here is minimal. So while we take the usual walk down to the hydropower and adjust the nozzles, I just like to share this this saying in Danish, which goes like this: "Hopo, hopo." And directly translated, then it means calm on. Calm on. Turn calm on. And it's inspired by some of Martin Borosin's videos on YouTube about one moment meditation. One moment meditation. Why does he speak about one moment meditation? I usually speak about 1 hour meditation. This is because he knows that the modern man, which he deals with also professionally, they are so busy, 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 busy. So they only have one spare moment to do meditation. That's why he called it one moment meditation. He has some great videos on YouTube. I recommend them. Martin Borosin. And he also have an app for your mobile phone. And his point is very both neat, elegant, apt, and very, 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 very suitable for the times today. It links up actually with something that is very Buddhist and very early, and that many teachers, including myself, also promote time and time again. And this just is that it takes only one moment to establish awareness on presence, on right here and now. It takes only one breath, breathing in, present. Breathing out, present. And then you're back to where your consciousness really belongs, in the present, in the real here and now. Forever changing, yes, that's true. But that's not a good reason to be stressed about it. Well, it comes and then it goes. So be it, so have it always been. There's no big deal there. The paradoxical and very strange things about modern times is that the technological culture has been focused upon building appliances, mechanics, electronics, all kinds of stuff, so that humans can save time. However, the very same humans, they seem to get less and less time. So Martin Borson, he speaks about time poverty, that the culture of today is in a constant, very stressed, winded up time poverty, where they always feel subjectively, and I think unnecessarily, that they are in a lack of time, a desperate, sapping, lack of time. While that actually not is the case. This subjective lack of time is something that mind invents. And as Martin also notes, time may not be a article of the physical reality. It may be something mind made, something mind make up, and therefore it can wind it up in great speeds, and then it feels physical stress, or it can wind it down to other subjective speeds, and even though a large amount of time is passing in a very short time or experienced very accurately, then the mind can still be calm. An example of that will be your enlightenment moment, where you experience from 400,000 to 40 billion lives in 4 hours, in all detail, in more presence that you have now, regarding this bag of bones, emulating a Buddhist monk talking about presence and awareness. So again, back to the Viking saying,
Opo, Vena, Opo.
If I should translate it to English, instead of saying calm on, which is a literal translation, then it, one could say take it easy, breezy, easy breezy. I don't mean to be careless, not at all actually, because to dwell in presence is worship. Something where one is hyper aware and not careless at all. Not at all. Rather the opposite. One has full focus but is a laid back, take it easy, relaxed focus on all the minute details going on out there and in here at the same time, simultaneously. And in the ideal case, effortlessly. I repeat, effortlessly. And why is that so? It is so because one has taken this one moment to reestablish awareness in equipoise, in equanimity, upekkha, parami. The 10th mental perfection. When succeeding, then it is exceedingly pleasant, because at the same time of having a subjective feeling of floating in the moment, one seems to be looking into a microscope with one eye and a telescope with the other eye. seeing everything at the same time, both those things that are distant, very distant in the telescope, and those things that are very minute in the microscope. Both remembering what happened long time ago in the past, while still remaining anchored here in the present. It is a rare state of mind. However, as one trains it and becomes more and more aware of it. And right now I'm working on a series of awareness, Sati, that, as the Buddha say, is always advantageous. Sati has comes under many headings in Buddhism. Awareness or presence, I think it's the best translations. Mindfulness is the worst. Unfortunately, that's how it's taken up by the present day stress, sip, culture. Mindfulness. I don't think this is without a reason, because those who made that translation, their mind is full to the brim of irrelevant objects. And therefore they made that translation. While those who have come little further out in the forest, a little further down the path, they were translated to awareness of presence. I think awareness is the best, because presence, if you say presence, then it is stumblingly close and inherent that if there's presence, then somebody or something is present. That's not the case. It's a state. But there's no one or nothing being present in this presence. It's the state itself that is the thing, Sati. One could fall into the wrong view of ascribing a ego or me or self or abiding personality that had this or dwelled in this presence and thereby was present. But this is not the case. The presence is present, but there's no one being present. So because of this tendency to fall into this mistake of personality belief or ego projection, then I think awareness is a better translation of the word Sati. It's still cool, and now we come down to the hydropower. You can hear it spinning. It starts less and less water. So we have to turn it down. Over and out. The ancient commentaries says that this awareness, this Sati, is a presence that has to stand by. A presence that has to stand by. On standby. Stand by close and look at. It's, in other words, a passive, silent observer in mind. An extra perspective in mind. On what? On mind itself. It is mind looking at mind. It is mind seeing mind. As soon as mind sees mind being present and calm, then mind smiles. Why so? Because whether it's in the middle of a traffic jam or you just got a major bill dumped in the door through the mailman, or it is your boss losing his head again, or your wife, or your dog, or your cat, or your friend, or even yourself. Your so-called imaginary self. Well, if mind is not seeing mind at that particular moment, at that very instant, because he has forgotten to stand by, to be present, it's gotten so absorbed in usually fake emotions and other funny, unfortunately very little funny stuff. Well, then, if mind then reestablishes itself, by using the trick of being aware, just aware of the breath coming in and the breath going out. Well, boom. Presence, mind seeing mind, mind smiling, mind calm, noticing whatever there might be externally of physical things or live beings or situations, whether pleasant, painful or neutral, whether past, future, or right here and now, then it just sees what there is to see. So be it. The presence remain there looking. So it's an unlooking activity. What is used as microscope? Plop, said the frog as many times before. What is used as microscope in this situation? If this is a binocular and telescope and scanner, it is always seeing whatever there is to see through four things, the Four Noble Truths. It sees that whatever there is out there, whatever there was back there, whatever there is in here, mental or physical, high or low, beautiful or ugly, past, present or future, it always was and will always remain only one thing, And that's suffering, dukkha. And it sees also that craving for these very same things, phenomena, states, beings, situations, whatever they may be, it was this craving for them that created that suffering. However, as soon as this presence stands by, this is awareness is established. Then there's no craving for them. Who craves for suffering? This only a sadomasochist can do, huh? Well, it's possible that we all are, to some extent, sadomasochistic practitioners, because we run around in samsara and we have done it for a long time, huh? But nevertheless, when this presence standing by, it remains absorbed into this presence. Well, then it sees that the end of suffering is, of course, by logic, by inference, that as soon as this craving ends, well, then this suffering also ends. So it asks itself naturally, oh, okay. Yodi-ho, here we go. What's then the way, the method to make this craving cease irreversibly so it do not ever rearise? So it makes like a palm tree that is cut down, a palm tree stump, as the Buddha say. Because if you cut down a palm tree, because the growing point is up in the top of the tree, it will never regrow from the root. It's impossible. Impossible. So what's the method to make craving the cause of suffering irreversibly cease, evaporate, never come back, never rearise, never come back and bite you in the bum and say, ha ha, I'm still here? That's just this Noble Eightfold Way, which is right view, Samaditti. Right motivation, Samma Sankappa. Right speech, Samma Vajja. Right action, Samma Kamanta. Right livelihood, Samma Ajiva. Right effort, Samma Vajama. Right awareness. Exactly right there. Boom. The presence that has to stand by. Right awareness, Samma Sati. And right concentration, Samma Samadhi. Culminating in right release, and knowledge and vision of right release. So is it, friends. Really, just so. Ta-ta-ta. It is not otherwise at all. Hope, friends, come on. One breath, ladies and gentlemen, one breath, one moment is enough to come out of all time poverty, stress, and zip-zap, flip-flap, here and there, distraction, going everywhere, at the same time. Thank you for your quite advantageous attention. This I was true. Your clever consideration. Considering the matter again and again. Wherever you are. Whatever the circumstances might be. And not the least for your kind contribution. Hopo, come on and have a nice day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.